I thought it was a good story and that it gave you a chance to look inside of an event that took place that is a piece of American history.
At its core, this is just a really good story.
I hope somebody comes away from this performance feeling like, you know, there was truth on screen.
This is about a group of people that were underground, were very close, they were very bonded by the style of their time, and the passions of their time.
It talks about the Weather Underground, which was a movement, obviously, from the 60s and 70s.
You have some 20-somethings in the 70s who decided to take charge of their lives and felt like they had no power and no say in their government. What started off as a diplomatic conversation among college students wound up turning into a militarized gang. Looking for public targets to bring the war home because people weren't paying attention and the news felt distant.
A federal grand jury in Detroit today charged the 13 top leaders of the Weathermen with plotting to bomb public buildings in Chicago, Detroit, New York, and Berkeley, California. The Weathermen are the militant faction of the Students for a Democratic Society. Only one of the 13 is now in custody.
They were targeting these particular institutions to cast light on what was going on, but also because the nonviolent action that they were involved in seemed to be getting nowhere, and we know what the state of the world is now. So they were trying out something that might achieve their goals.
They took to the streets, and in the midst of taking to the streets, there was a rock star element that they started winding up in the papers. There started being Weathermen groupies. And in the midst of this, a family was created. And in the midst of this family being created, fear popped up. And rationalizations popped up. And the group disintegrated. And people went on to become adults and live their own lives.
There's all this these multiple feelings and relationships. And how they interacted is what interested me.
It's about a couple of members who have been in hiding for decades and are now on the run from the law again. Much later on in their lives.
Three suspects remain at large after a security guard was shot and killed during a robbery at the Bank of Michigan. The FBI has released the names Mimi Lurie, Nicholas Sloan, and Sharon Solars, all members of the radical anti-war group, the Weather Underground.
You have this group living in exile, spread out throughout the country, still with communication lines, but very underground.
Now they've grown older and they've taken different paths. Some people resent that they did it. Some people have remorse that they did it. Some people believed in it at the time but feel they had to spend the rest of their lives paying for it. Other people still feel the same way, still feel that that was a just cause at the time and still is a cause for today.
I'm Ben Shepherd, Albany Sun-Times. You spoke on the phone. I just figured I'd come by and say hi.
I don't really have anything to say. Oh, and Susan, would you pull out the Rochester files from
you don't
my
know what I'm gonna ask you yet.
From my deposition? What?
I said you don't know what I'm going to ask you yet.
Unless you're a reporter.
Well, I could just put refuse to answer any questions.
What?
I'm just doing a little background, sir.
Okay.
Thank you. You have one man posing as a lawyer on the East Coast who is sort of an idealist, defending people for free, helping the immigrant find, you know, his paperwork, the hurricanes of the world. He's that guy, the public defender, the Walt Whitman of the law community. And a young reporter, long story short, finds out he's not what he says he is.
So, did Sharon Solars contact you prior to her arrest?
Does it matter? Since you already printed that she did?
Actually, what was printed was that she may have approached a public interest lawyer who declined to take the case, but your name was never mentioned.
There are 25 lawyers in the area. 9 do criminal, 6 do accidents, 5 do D's and 4 do closings, and then there's me.
I wasn't insinuating.
The hell with accuracy, huh? Be vague, be accusatory, and whatever sticks. Is that how it works?
Nothing I wrote was false.
You made it seem like I was harboring a known fugitive.
It is an activist being undercover and living a lie, living a life as a lie. But it's kind of trying to clear his name. It's kind of going to your past and finding people from your past to unlock a puzzle, solve a mystery.
And in that sense, it's a little bit like, for me, it was a little bit like Les Miserables, the character Jean Valjean, you know, 19 years for a loaf of bread, and he went and he escaped from prison, built a false identity, had a daughter, had a good life, but it was always going to haunt him, the pain of that time. So how do these people deal with that? Did they change? Did they not change? To me, that's the interesting story to be told. It's not so much about the movement itself, because that belongs to history.
It's hard to know, I mean, especially when you're in a rebellion or a revolution, it's hard to know how far to take it, you know, at what point and at what cost to yourself and to your kids down the road. And I think there are a couple lines in this movie that really deal with that, where people say, you know, we certainly don't regret any of the things we did maybe, but we would have done them differently.
They did not want to go fight a war they didn't believe in, and so they rebelled against it. I sympathize with that. At the time,
they were in a situation where they were getting ready to get drafted, had no say in that. It's sort of a hopeless feeling.
Never before has this nation fought a war which so many Americans opposed for so many different reasons. Never has this dissent been as emotional, as intense, as is the dissent against the war in Vietnam.
The bomb went off in the State Department and did a lot of damage. Another was detonated in Oakland.
It was a really volatile time in the 60s, and it's interesting because all the characters that were playing, I mean, we were around that time, and some of us marched and did things like that, so it's really fascinating to do this.
Well, I was raising a family and starting a career, so I was not involved politically at that time. If there was any politics in my life that was at all activist, it was around the environment. On the other hand, I had a lot of friends who were involved. I was probably on the outer edge of that movement. I saw what was happening. I could see the good of it, the reason people were so passionate, because there was a draft then. There is not a draft now. If there was a draft, I think we would have had a repeat of that.
Look, I'm just trying to put the pieces together.
Listen, I didn't take the case because I'm a single parent with a private practice and too much on my plate, all right? If I could have helped, I would have.
Because you're sympathetic to their cause? You agree with her tactics?
You know, clearly you have some kind of an agenda here. I don't have time for this bullshit.
I don't, actually. I don't care much for either side.
So what, that makes you fair and balanced? You know, it's a funny thing. 30 years ago, a smart guy like you probably would have been involved with the movement yourself.
When you're living through a time, you're not aware of what the time is about. Only in retrospect, when you look back and say, oh, I see what was going on.
Hindsight always gives you a lot of knowledge that you, of course, don't have at the time. And of course, when the Vietnam War was happening, I think it was just so, so awful that people didn't know how to stop it. And so it seemed like, you know, taking that kind of violence was the only way.
They all were finding that normal protest wasn't working, and they resorted to an extension of that normal protest into violent protest, because they had to make something work.
Most of us led very sheltered lives. We had no real relationship with violence. But at that time, all these kids were taking to the streets in Japan and France, China, Angola. There was revolution, and I wanted to be part of it.
Actions have consequences, and decisions that people make, one, they have to accept it, and then they have to live with it. And some people couldn't do that. That's interesting.
It is about consequences. Things we think we outlived, sometimes we haven't.
It's not uninteresting to revisit that particular moment of American history. I think it's very difficult to do, very difficult, because we've been filled with such propaganda, and it's very difficult to turn that propaganda around without it seeming like propaganda itself.
Looking at American history is an interesting idea, and what lessons could be learned from history. Fortunately, many of us don't learn from lessons from history, but whether they will in this one or not, but I do think particularly young people, my kids, their kids, will be interested in this event in history that took place when young people were their age now. It's kind of interesting that it seems to be coinciding with some sort of a movement that's reminiscent of this one, with the young people rebelling against what they feel is an injustice and a government that doesn't really recognize them and is making decisions that they don't agree with.
You have essentially what's bubbling now, which is a real animosity amongst the youth because they feel powerless.
It's the same thing in terms of justice and equality for people, and not, it's exactly the same thing in terms of that, of the money being in the hands of 1 or 2% everywhere. You see that, and it's just shocking it should be happening in the modern Western world.
I think we're seeing a kind of maybe a little more of a, you know, citizens protesting, taking a stand now. You're seeing it more. It's interesting. It'll be interesting to know when this film comes out where we are in this country.